Hello everyone, this is Meera here. I have come up with the last portion of the poem Death of Krishna today. So in this lecture we would be dealing with the poem Death of Krishna thoroughly. So I hope you all staying safe and you like the previous video. If you like these videos, please do like, share, subscribe and support for the upcoming videos. So straight away moving on into the poem Death of Krishna by Sitakant Mahapatra. Death of Krishna. The ordained fateful arrow finally arrived. It hit the tired feet of the cowherd boy, Arjuna's charioteer, the primeval lover, the villain boy, the romantic emperor, trembled and in a moment went still. So here, the first paragraph of the poem, the poet tells us that the arrow which was to hit the feet of Krishna was ordained. That means it was pre-decided. When by the time when Krishna was born in the prison house itself, it was decided that Krishna should die in such a manner. So the arrow which was already pre-decided to hit the feet of Lord Krishna hit onto the Lord Krishna's feet. So the first line of the poem itself sets the background of this poem. And it was also, the poet tells us that it was preset that Lord Krishna should die in such a manner, and that the arrow, and that arrow which was to kill Lord Krishna finally arrived and hit the feet of Lord Krishna. The poet says that the arrow hit the feet of tired Krishna, who has played numerous roles in his life on this earth. He was a cowherd boy, he was Arjuna's charioteer, he was a well-known lover. Primeval lover means historical lover, who was well-known, whose fame as a lover is passed on from generation to generation. So he was a primeval lover, the Vili envoy. Vili envoy means the cunning messenger. He was the romantic emperor. So a person who played these many roles in his earthly existence finally was hit by an arrow, and when he was hit by the arrow, he trembled for a moment and then went still. So his death was very calm. In the line, in here in the first paragraph, we see the usage. It hit the tired feet of the cowherd boy. Here the poet uses the poetical device of transferred epithet. Here the poet is talking about the cowherd boy, the Lord Krishna, who was Arjuna's charioteer, who was a cunning messenger, and moreover who was a very powerful diplomat and a popular lover. So he played all these roles throughout his life. He is tired now because Lord Krishna himself realizes that it is the moment of his death, or the moment of his death has arrived, and now he is taking a little bit of rest in his life because he is tired of doing all these roles throughout his life. So it is not the feet that is tired, but it is Lord Krishna who is tired and resting there. So the poet in the very first paragraph itself tells us that after having completed all the roles that was designed for Lord Krishna to play throughout his earthly existence, having completed all those roles, having overwhelmed by his own karma, the arrow hit the feet of Krishna, who was resting in the mango groves of the Dwaraka, who was resting there tired. Now moving on to the second paragraph. The long way to return to Vaikuntha ended. The working of karma, the litanies of treachery and retribution, the heartbreaking silence, the remorse that had dawned after the din of Kurukshetra, all of it ended. So in the second poem, in the second paragraph of this poem, the poet tells us that everything that happened after the birth of Krishna, everything was simulated by the birth of Lord Krishna. For example, poet tells us that since his birth in the prison house, everything was stimulated by the birth of Lord Krishna. So since his birth, all his karma was for finally leading him to return back to the Vaikuntha.
So after having completed all his roles as a popular lover, as a cunning messenger, as Arjuna's charioteer, as a popular diplomat, as a famous lover, having completed all these many roles throughout his life, now it is the time for Lord Krishna to leave his earthly existence and move on to Vaikuntha. So he has been waiting a long time for this moment to return back to Vaikuntha. Now the all his karma, for example, karma means all his duties or whatever things that he did. That is, for example, the poet mentions here a few of his karmas. The litanies of treachery. Litanies refers to the continuous prayer-like chanting, and treachery is cheating. So throughout Mahabharata, we can find this cheating has a very recurring throughout the story of Mahabharata, and retribution. As like cheating, also there were punishments. Okay, since the Mahabharata shows us a lot of moral decline, it shows us the many, like how Draupadi was demeaned in front of others by the Kauravas. So all there was a lot of moral decline, and also there was retribution. Retribution means punishments. There was a heartbreaking silence during the time of a lot of unwanted circumstances in the Pandavas' life during this fratricidal revenge. There was a lot of heartbreaking silence. There was remorse. Remorse means the feeling of guilt, and all these things which had dawned means surfaced, or which has come up after the Kurukshetra war. All this ended with the death of Krishna. Actually, what the poet is trying to tell us is that Krishna in fact stimulated the Kurukshetra war, because all he wanted was to re-establish justice in the surface of this earth. So it was Krishna who stimulated the Pandavas to fight against the Kauravas, who were more in number, as well as they had many brilliant warriors in their foes. But it was Krishna who stimulated this war, and it was the cunning plot made by Krishna that led to the Kurukshetra war, and also led to the victory of the Pandavas. So all these litanies of treachery, retribution, heartbreaking silence, the feeling of guilt, and all these things which had come up with the Kurukshetra war, all this ended with the death of Lord Krishna. So this is being told in the second paragraph. Now moving on to the third paragraph. A great wind from the sea across Dwaraka carried the piteous wail of Jara the hunter, soaked in the black rain of the mango blossoms and coil song. So in this paragraph, we find the Jara hunter who mistook the foot of Lord Krishna to be a red coil and shot him with his arrow. So since Jara the hunter didn't do this thing deliberately, he didn't hit Krishna with his arrow deliberately, Jara was imbibed by his own sorrowful state of mind and began to cry. He cried so loud that the whole of Dwaraka heard it, and his cry was like a resembled like a black rain in the black rain amongst the mango blossoms. Now moving on to the next paragraph. Bent under the weight of guilt, the dark voices of ancient rituals wept in the wombs of prison houses. In frolics and razas of yesterdays, on forsaken moonlit river banks, down glittering royal courts and avenues of falling armies. Okay, so in this paragraph, the poet tells us about the effect of Krishna's death on this world. Here, bent under the weight of guilt, the dark voices of ancient rituals wept in the wombs of prison houses. Here, the prison houses are compared with the wombs of women bearing children. So here, the poet tried to tell us that all the stories related to Krishna, it began with his birth in the prison house as the son of Devaki and Vasudeva. So, here Krishna tell us that, sorry, the poet tell us about Krishna, that all these ancient rituals which was associated with the birth of Krishna, all of you would be knowing how Lord Krishna was born in the prison house, how he escaped from the hands of Kamsa and was placed in the womb near the in the Yadava community, the head of Yadava, Nandagovar and Yashoda, and so on. The stories like that. So all these ancient rituals associated with the birth of Lord Krishna, they all began to weep, bent under the weight of guilt. Everywhere there was guilt. For example, all the plays and rasas of the yesterdays. Lord Krishna is famous for his rasa leelas. So all those rasa leelas and plays made by Lord Krishna on the moonlit river banks of Yamuna, and all his famous twisting of truths. Lord Krishna was very much popular for telling half truths. He never lied. Nobody can say that he lied, but he was very well known in telling half truths. So down the glittering royal courts and avenues of falling armies, all his Ras Leelas in the in the moonlit river banks of Yamuna, and all his play with words or telling of his half truths in the royal courts, and his play and his twisting of clothes with the falling armies, all this wept because of the being bent under the guilt of the death of Lord Krishna.